Good evening and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Paolo Barlera. I'm the interim director of the Italian Cultural Institute in New York, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to the sixth and last episode of the series Until Further Notice, a series of webinars to talk about the current state of affairs of contemporary art. And since it's the last episode, I would like to spend a few words to thank the curator and coordinator of the series, Maurita Cardone, who is joining us from New York. And here she is. Thank you very much, Maurita, for all your work and your
Thank you.
dedication to the series. For tonight's episode, we have as usual, two geographically distant participant panelists. We have Amy Fontana joining us from Los Angeles, and we have Luca Vitone joining us from Milan in Italy. And I will leave the microphone and the screen to Maurita as usual. Thank you.
Thank you, Paolo, and thank to the Italian Cultural Institute for organizing this. Thank you very much. And thank to our audience for being us with us today and in the previous episodes. As Paolo mentioned, this is our final episode, and I wanted to use this occasion to put together some of the deeper and wider conversations that came up in the previous episodes. So we decided to change a little bit of our usual format. And instead of having either two curators or two artists, today we have a curator and an artist. I will briefly introduce them as I usually do, and then we'll start our conversation. At the end of our talk, there will be time for a few questions from the audience, so stick with us until the end, and if you want to ask a question, you can use the Q&A button. Amy Fontana opened the Amy Fontana Gallery in Milan in 1992. In the early 2000s, she started to spend most of her time in Los Angeles, where in 2002, she organized a show by Katy LaRocca at the Italian Cultural Institute. Under the label of West of Rome, she later produced a series of projects, including using the sprawling Los Angeles urban spaces as an exhibition venue. Among these projects was the groundbreaking Women in the City, with works by Cindy Sherman, Barbara Kruger, Jenny Holzer, and Louise Lawler, disseminated in more than 300 locations across Greater Los Angeles. In 2011, Fontana collaborated with the Getty Research Institute for Pacific Standard Time Art in LA, 1945-1986. Curating a series of performances based on the influence of the women building. In 2013, Fontana curated with Andrea Lissoni a large show by Mike Kelly at Hangar Bicocca in Milan. From 2013 to 2019, Fontana worked on different art and writing projects, including Liliana Moro's Underdog at the GAM in Rome. In recent years, Fontana's work has been orienting more towards helping underserved communities in Los Angeles through the means of art and yoga. In his artistic practice, Luca Vitone focuses on the idea of place and invites us to learn new ways of knowing something we already know. His work explores how places are identified and represented through cultural production. Vitone bridges the gap between the sense of loss of place, typical of postmodern life, and the ways in which feelings of belonging arise at the intersection between personal and collective memory, drawing paths that create a subjective geography. In 2018, with the Romanistan project, he was among the winners of the fourth edition of the Italian Council call for proposals. In 2019, with his project Il Cerchio Rosso, in collaboration with Studio Boeri Architetti, he created the temporary installation La Radura della Memoria, dedicated to the victims of the collapse of the Morandi Bridge in Genova, Italy. Since 2006, he has been teaching at the Nuova Accademia di Belle Arti Milan. His work has been shown extensively throughout the world, including at MoMA PS1 in New York, where he had a solo show in 2000, and at the 2003 and 2013 Venice Biennale. Thank you, Amy, and thank you, Luca, for being here. Luca, where are you?
Hi, everybody.
Hello, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you for inviting us.
So, as we usually do, I like to start from the beginning. From when the pandemic started. So, why don't you tell us a little bit about where you were when this all started back in March? What was your life, everyday life, like at the time? And if your daily routine was affected at all by all this? And we'll start with Amy.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for joining us, to all the participants. I was in Los Angeles. I saw the pandemic starting first in Italy. And I followed that really closely because I have family and friends in Italy. And I didn't have any illusion that it would not to come here. So some people here was thinking that maybe would not have come here, but I was pretty sure reading like a little bit of scientific papers, and so I realized that it was matter of weeks, and in fact so it was. So as soon as the pandemic got here, yes, my life, like the life of everyone else in the world, changed. I normally, my daily activity include, some people who know me well know that I've been teaching yoga, especially to underserved community. So on Skid Row, LA, for an organization called Skid Row Out and Trust. And of course, that was the first thing to go to cast, because it wasn't safe at all. So, and then also like another class that I teach normally during the week in a studio. So that was the first cut. And then I retired into my house, and I started to cultivate, you know, I write, so I study a lot. So I started to, I didn't miss the outside world so much. I miss certain things of the outside world. Actually, the last thing, if I go back with my memory, the last thing that, one of the last events that I went to was at the end of February here in Los Angeles, was the opening of the Frieze Art Fair here, where I saw a lot of friends from the art world, et cetera. And they were still hugging, kissing, but we knew that it was coming. So, so then I just retired here in my house with my cat, and I started to live on Zoom like everyone else, I guess.
And we are still on Zoom.
And here we are still on Zoom. So, but I, for the kind of life, you know, I'm social, that I have a lot, in a way that I have a lot of friends, and I go to see shows and stuff like that. But not, I'm not a social life, you know, I don't go to openings so much anymore. I have done that. So it was not like a shock for me or like a huge change. Actually, I appreciate part of the possibility of focusing on studying and writing. And yeah, so that's to start off.
What was your experience, Luca? Where were you?
So when it happens, I was in Berlin and I had to go back to Milan. So there were not problems to take the flight, but already the airport was quite empty, and most of the flights were canceled, and the atmosphere was more or less, or what I felt, that was like September 11. The week after I came to New York, and I remember that for the first time, I saw an empty airport. I mean, nobody was there in JFK, that usually is crowded, and you know better than me how it is. So, and Berlin Schönefeld was also like that. I lived in Berlin for 10 years, so I know quite well the situation there. That was more quiet than here. And when I arrived in Milan, I was a little bit shocked because the town that I found was completely different as my memory can remember. I mean, everything was, there was a void. I mean, there was so empty everywhere, no cars, no people. And day after day, I fall down, in a strange atmosphere, in silence, nobody on the street, no cars. The only sound that there were the bells of the church. I mean, not that bells, but I mean, in the total silence, you can hear much better the music of bells. And unfortunately, sirene, but the alarms of ambulance.
Yeah, ambulance. Is...
The sirens of ambulance. Yeah. That was, strange is not the best word to say. Right. So for the first 2 weeks, we were alone at home, me, my wife, and my child. Of course, school was closed, everything was closed. And the only possibility to go outside was to go to the supermarket.
Right.
All the shops were closed, only supermarket, only tobacco shops and newspaper shops. I mean, and of course, pharmacies, drugstore. Right.
And you were mentioning the other day that you had actually just recently moved to Milan from Berlin, right? When this all started.
Last year.
So it was a city that was kind of new to you, but even newer because of this.
You know, for me, Milan is probably my first town.
Okay.
Because I moved from Genova and Bologna, where I studied, in 1990 to Milan, and then I moved to Berlin at the end in 2010. So for 20 years, I was based there. Of course, for my job, I was always on the way, traveling around, but I was based still in Milan.
Right.
And that was also quite curious for my life, that with the lockdown, was for sure my first time in the life that I never took a flight, but also this year from I have to say that I went to Berlin again in September, and they were the only two flights that I had during the year, and it's something quite strange. If I go, I went twice to visit my mother in Genova. it was a sort of a travel.
Yeah, for people who are used to travel, that must have been a real shock, and I can relate to that. Go ahead, Amy.
I'd like to add on a little bit to what Luca said. Of course, also, I mean, I've been cutting my traveling a little bit in the past years, but still, I mean, I go to Italy twice a year. I go to San Francisco a lot. I travel like almost every month to San Francisco. And so all this travel for me has been also cut. But I'm not sure what's your next question, Maurita, and that this may be part of it. So one thing that I want to say that for us here in the United States, it has been a very difficult year because there was not just the pandemic, at the end of March, George Floyd was
absolutely
killed.
Absolutely, and we're gonna get
that,
there.
The course, in a certain way, changed the course of history, I wanna say. We started to have a lot of protests, the rising of the movement Black Lives Matter, and also episode of violence, looting and stuff like that. So adding on to the pandemics, there was also the situation, explosive situation that we have been going through. And in a way, we are still in it a little bit, culminating with election. So I just want to add
And of course, I do want to talk about this and we'll get there. But first I wanted to frame the situation. So I want to go back to the everyday life, because I'm interested in knowing if this, what was happening was in a way, in any way entering your work, and specifically because the pandemic kind of forced us to rethink many things that we do take for granted in our everyday life. I'm wondering how that entered your works, both of your works, and specifically about Luca's work, because he's so used to travel, and he also brings into his work this sense of place and the concept of roots, of identity. I'm wondering if the pandemic made you think about that or rethink about that, and how. Meaning, for example, the first thing I really had to redefine was, what is home to me? How do I define home? So I'm wondering if that entered your work anyhow, considering that your work talks about, deals with the sense of identity and belonging. Luca.
Yes, and I would like also to say that in all this, bad view about the lockdown and the feeling that there were in Milan in March, April, and May, I have to say that for us, I mean for my family, was also a good opportunity to stay all together and to discovering the life, the family life all together. My wife is a musician, and she's always on travel and reaching theater in Europe and so. And I have to also to say that it was also very beautiful for us to, for the first time in our life, to have so much time to stay all together at home. That is not so nice because, I mean, it's not so nice. For us, it was very beautiful, but of course, the situation was not the best one. And for me, at the beginning, I was at home. I'm a teacher at the academy, as you read before. And so I had my lessons by online. So, and I start to try to this. I'm not so so good with digital
technologies.
Technology and so, okay. But in a few days I learned how to do it. Mm-hmm. And then we start to, for some, we had, I knew all my students only by the screen, and that is also quite strange because it's something that, when I saw some of them after, at the end of summer, it was strange to see people in the real life when you have this experience to see only by screen. Anyway, I have also to say that there was also a lot to do because, of course, shows, lectures, they start to transform the idea to do them by the web, but the shows not. And then we wait for the summer because something happened in the summer, or everything was postponed for the time that should become in the future.
But did you use that time at all to think about some of the concepts that you usually bring into your work.
It was a strange situation also for that, because we were not in solitude. We were not alone. We were always connected with somebody, because this idea that nobody could go out make everybody using telephone, using WhatsApp, using Skype, using Zoom. We start to use Zoom.
Yeah, that's, if I can interject for a moment, that's the paradox that we are living, you know, to be like all separated in our like reality, but also all connected like never before.
Right.
And that's something we were talking about also when we prepare for, you know, even Luke and I, that are all friends, have been in touch much more than we normally are during this month of the pandemic. I've been in touch with my friends all over the world. So there is this interesting, that's a very interesting feeling of being isolated and overconnected, hyperconnected.
Yes, yeah, that's true, that's true.
We started to have a daily appointment with friends that friends, of course, but that never happened before. No?
Obviously.
We spent 2 weeks or months with no calls or and not. In that time, every day at 6 o'clock, I don't know, we had a sort of appointment.
Marita asked about the work specifically. I can give it a quick start. Maybe Luca can follow up with his own work.
Please.
For me, because I'm focusing mostly on my writing, I decided I wanted to write, but I didn't know what, I mean, I wanted to write about something that made sense for me during this time. I'm working on a memoir kind of book. So I started to write about my travels, and many of these travels is also interesting because many of these travels that I did between the end of the 80s and the 90s, I did it with Luca actually. So I focus my writing activity on going back to these memories when the world was still like an open canvas, I want to say, an open space for us to circulate, because what has been harder in a way during this pandemic, even we are all isolated, but it's almost like we have been dealing with this physical sense of confinement.
Right.
And that's also why I thought about Luca's work when Marita and I were talking about who to invite, because Luca's work is very much about borders, is very much about space and the geographical, political limitation of space and the social. This is also has been a big topic during this pandemic, and especially here in the United States, because of the administration, like with the immigration related issues, and the issue of public space, that is a topic that interests me a lot.
Right. And I do want to go back to public space and public art, actually, but since you mentioned traveling and the idea of borders, of course, that's one of the main consequences of the pandemic. The borders are closed all over the world. We're stuck here. We can't move. But actually, this brings me to Luca's work, one of his most recent works, the one I also mentioned in the bio, and that was actually shown last summer at Cold Springs in Magazzino Italian Arts Cinema in Piazza. This is a work that is about moving across borders. This is a work that follows, actually retraces backwards the trip, the journey of the population of the Roma population from India to Europe. And he did this work a year ago, I think, right, Luca? And he did this work right before this all started. So I'm wondering, Luca, if that work, do you see that work differently now? I mean, that work wouldn't have been possible at all today. I'm wondering if you see more different meanings in that work because of what happened afterwards. And if you want to talk a little bit more about the work, because I only said a few words, I feel free.
I don't know. As you said already, it was a project that for sure a year later couldn't be done. And but not only for the lockdown, not only for the COVID, but also another thing was the war in between Armenia and Azerbaijan, for example, because we traveled across Armenia, and probably now this year it would be difficult to have the permission to go across, or also not only to have the permission, but also for us, for our safe. Right. It was not so nice to travel in a country where bombs were following. So that was probably also the travel is also this kind of travel that was an idea starting from Bologna, going back to India, on the reverse migration travel of the Roman Sinti, as you said, in a way is also a sort of metaphor of an idea of travel that is not more the possibility that we are not able to do it again or to repeat this kind of experience. It was also something.
It's not like.
In fact, that.
No, I just want to say. To interrupt you for a second, Luca, I just want to say, I mean, I love, you know how much I love this work, you know, the Romanista work, and like these traveling are not possible anymore, and they were also like so typical of a generation, like the generation of the 60s that first travels to India, always fascinated me so much that they were going through roads, like through the same kind of itinerary that Luca did for his Romanista project. Right. Sorry to interrupt.
No. You said a very important thing, because in fact, this kind of travel, it started to be impossible to do it from the end of the 70s. We have an idea we had the opportunity to go directly by Earth, to go to the East, Island. India, Afghanistan, until the end of the 70s. With the Khomeinistian revolution, the invasion of Afghanistan at the end of the same year, 79, by the Soviet Union, everything was closed. And then from that time until now, it's not easy for people that is traveling only to visiting, not for a commercial
reasons, purpose.
Purpose, thank you. Is not possible anymore. And also our travel last year, 2019, was also not so easy, because it was not possible to travel across Pakistan. Right. From Iran to go to Pakistan, there is a huge territory that is called Balochistan. That part of Balochistan is in Pakistan, the main one, but there is Balochistan in Iran too, and in Afghanistan. And that area is almost closed for visitors. Because my project was also supported by the Cultural Ministerium, Italian Cultural Ministerium. And we had also with the Foreign Affairs, how do you say, Farnesina, Ministry of Affari Esteri, we had also the support. And thanks to them, we had the visa to go to travel across Pakistan. But Pakistan was not so happy to have
They were happy to have you there.
Because that is very important, because for them, we were a problem. Because if an attack or un attentato, how do you say an attentato?
Like a terrorist attack or anything.
A terrorist attack. Few European fall down in this terrorist attack. For them, as a government, there were more
problems.
They didn't like to have this problem, no? With us. So at the end, thanks to Farnesina, we had our visa and we could do our travel, our journey. Fortunately, we had no problems. I have to say that, as almost usual, everywhere we found smiles and fantastic hostly people, very kind and very supportive also, and so so. But in a way, it's also something that is not so easy to do it. I mean, I probably, if we were there as normal tourists, probably was not so easy to have the opportunity to travel.
I have to say that I'm really, I love that project of Luca, because I know since how long Luca had this idea of realizing this project, and his work with the Roma people goes back at the beginning of the 90s actually, yeah. And then evolved like in this bigger project. So I'm so happy, and I think it's so meaningful that he was able to realize the project just a year before the pandemic hit, and then we have been saying now it would not be possible anymore. That even give more value to the work itself.
Right. One of the things I listened to an interview you gave to, I think it was Magazzino, by the way, and you were saying that one of the things that you find interesting in the Roma people is the fact that that whereas we know where we come from, they have been disconnected from their roots for so long, they traveled for so long that they might not know exactly where they came from, and it's a whole journey. And I was thinking that, you know, this is something that is always often said also about African Americans, that were not only their freedom was taken, but their cultural identity was taken when they were brought here from Africa, and they lost track of their origins, of their roots. So this brings me to the other topic that that Emmy was mentioning, the fact that we this year we haven't only seen the consequences, the tragic consequences of the pandemic, but we have also been through the social upheaval that came with the anti-racist protests. And so, Amy, you have been in this country for a while. I'm curious to know, and you've worked as a curator, and you know, cultural institutions have been really under attack.
Thank you for bringing this up, Maurita, because that's something that it's really important to me, as first of all, as being an immigrant into this country. So the issue of integration and cultural integration is very important to me. And of course, I have been aware all this year about the tragedy of African Americans in this country, and how, in a way, the problem of racism, and that goes back to slavism, has been completely removed. Also, sometimes I'm really shocked to see my liberal friends not being aware of the history, like wanting to sweep everything under the carpet a little bit. And so we are good people. And you know, Americans are great people. I really love American people. But this is a wound, you know? This is like a very deep fractures that exist in American society. And I think the time has come for this to be repaired. This brings me, so in a way, even if these are very difficult times we're going through, I'm really happy to be here in the US right now, because I think it is a wind of change. And it's all about, I hope it goes in the right direction. The situation is explosive. It could go both ways. But I feel there are finally some serious premises of doing a critic for people, for white people, to be doing a critical of exam of their history and their consciousness too, and really like open up to a different phase of history. And I think this country has now or ever really the opportunity to heal.
And do you see that happening? Like, do you see that awareness developing in the art world and culture institutions?
I think something has changed, and there are a lot more of discussions about the topic. I would pause for a moment on the word healing. Because I always associate also the word curating or taking care with the word of healing in a certain way. And there is always that beautiful, one of my favorite story about the anthropologist Margaret Mead. Some of you may know that story. When she was asked, what is the sign of civilization? If you have to say one thing that for you represents civilization, what it would be. And she talked, and you can think she would have mentioned, I don't know, a beautiful painting or something like that. But she mentioned the finding of a human skeleton, which femur was healed to some intervention.
Oh, I see. No.
So the capacity of healing is, and the healing at the personal level and living as a healing as a society is really for me the most important sign of civilization. So going back to your question, to be more specific, yeah, there are a lot of talks, and you know this because you wrote about that as well, but you know, recently there was the case that I think was a little bit disgraceful of the Philippe Gaston show that was planned to start at the Tate and then go to the Washington National Gallery. And so we all know, I mean, some of you can look it up, people who don't know Philippe Gaston works, very important American artist. There are some of his paintings that represent the hooded figure of the Ku Klux Klan, but he was an activist for social rights, for civil rights.
Yeah.
So,
Luca? No, sorry. Please go on. Sorry.
It's okay, don't worry. So my theory that one of the reasons why he painted this figure is also because of stylistically he was interested into it, in the, like this hood, like with the pointed, because it fit well his style, like comic style of painting. But as you have followed, like a few months ago, they announced that the show was going to be canceled.
It was theoretically postponed, but postponed to 2024. How long is it going to take for you to think about it? Because they were saying need to think about the content of the show and reframe it in a way that is understandable.
Yeah, but I think that was really disgraceful. And I'm glad that the curator of the Tate came out publicly with this, because that generated a very interesting discussion about the topic. Because their motivation is saying, we don't want to create more, discomfort or more like upheaval showing these images. But then again, I want to think, what's the job of the curator and museum if not creating context for the images to be read in the right way. So in a way for me, these people gave up on their own job. So I think that was like, was a very interesting thing. And there has been a lot of discussion, and it's great that there are a lot of discussion around these topics. And in the quantity and easy, the intensity of this discussion, that I see the possibility of change.
I see. So yeah. The discussion itself is already a good sign, even if it's not yet producing.
Also because of social media, and we are all locked up. So people we are all expressing each other to social media, and when it's for good causes, I like it.
You wanted to say something, Luca, because yeah, I have a question for you.
Thinking about the Philippe Bouston querelle, that was really strange for me to hear that one, because it was, I didn't follow so well at the end, but at the beginning I was quite surprised that they decide to postpone or to cancel a show of important artist from also from another time. I mean, he's not a young, he's somebody that is already dead, and then
not contemporary. Yeah. Yeah.
And then also it was like, also, if you, as Amy said, this idea of this kind of paintings that were also quite easy to recognize, or as a comic, no, in a way, in a sort of pop,
yeah,
construction of the picture, but that was definitely a KKK, you know. So it was something. Why they had fear or problem to represent this kind of paintings? Probably was something that could how you say, infastidire the right wing of the.
I think it's more about bad conscience.
It's also that aspect as well, because ultimately, a lot of people who sit on museum boards are right wing people, and that's a reality that we have to face. Some of them are involved.
By the way, is still postponed? They decide something about the show?
They postponed. First, they postponed it to 2024. Then they said it's going to open in 2022, I think, at this point. So they shortened the time, but it's still postponed. Luca, we were talking, you know, since we're talking about racism, I remember you saying in one of the interviews about Romanistan, also that one of the things that interests you about that population, the Roma population, is that even people that in Italy are very progressive and anti-racist are usually very racist towards that specific population. So I'm wondering if you have some insights on that, because I think that's also related to a little bit to what is happening here. Of course, these are two different situations, but it's really about, you know, having to recognize the races within us before we even start, absolutely, you know, yeah, understanding what we have to do about it. So what is your experience? I mean, you traveled with this community for a while. What can you tell us a little bit about this?
You know, that is quite difficult, because I traveled with two Roma that before Santino and then Gennaro, Santino Spinelli and Gennaro Spinelli, they came with us for the travel. But you know, Santino is a man of my age. He is professor in university, he is musician, he is a part of the International Romani Union, that is the organization accepted by the United Nations as the organization that represents the Roma in the world. And Santino is the Italian in this organization. So I was with him, and we did the travel together. And that, of course, for us was an ambassador. It was really a person that know he knows everybody about the Roma, of course, the Roma community, and we were everywhere. We were accepted as friends or people of the huge family, you know. So it's quite strange. I have to say also that, for example, in the Eastern country, in the Balkans, in the Balkans, the situation is completely different from Italy. Probably also because the population of the Roma in the Balkan is more than in Italy or in the Western countries, I mean the France, Germany, and
that
so
there is a bigger population, that's what you're saying.
A big community, yes. And also people of the Roma community is also considered representative for the state. There are people that works in the parliament as parliamentary, how you say it?
Congressman.
Or minister for the government. They are teachers as in what?
Well, no, they are more integrated.
Integrate, exactly. Something that in Italy is completely different. But in Italy we have also a different kind of situation we called campi nomadi, that is something that is really near the apartheid or situation very deep, very bad. I don't know in English, but anyway.
What word are you looking at?
As really considered a way from the society. And the problem, because, for example, that the quite strange question is that in the 20% of the population lives in this bad situation. The other are living normally in towns as the other citizen of the country.
But weren't they kind of forced to renounce their own identity to be able to do that? And isn't that a consequence of the fact that we're not accepting them?
I think that government needs to have this situation to propose capo espiatorio.
Right.
Yes, a couple of all right.
Yeah, scapegoat.
For social when it happens for social problems or government problems. So, and that is something that unfortunately we lived and they lived. That is the problem.
Yeah. I want to quickly switch to another topic because we're getting to it's getting late. We're getting to the end of our hour together. But I do want to discuss this other topic because it has to do a lot with what Amy did in the past years not really beginning of her career, but almost. What I want to talk about is public art, because that's another thing that, you know, the pandemic is showing us, or is forcing us to see other ways to experience art. And of course, one of the options is to be outdoor. So yeah, let me frame the question because people are listening to what I'm saying.
I'm going to try to be brief and answer to your question right away.
Okay.
So I always said something, you know, that could be a very long story. I'm going to start to try to make it really short. As being like a gallerist, I always felt the constriction of the white cube, you know, of the gallery space. And I always had this idea to bring art outside, like in to the real realm of daily life, and make it available for everybody, also for people that is not interested in art, just making it available, like for these people, just to stumble into it and say, "Oh, what is that?" you know? And so that's why when I came to LA, so the city itself that I really love, and all the project of West of Rome, in a way they are my love song to Los Angeles, because the city itself, the urban space that is so horizontally spread, really offers a perfect set for public art. So that's why I started to do this project, this kind of project, and people that is curious can go and look it up, et cetera, et cetera. But it's interesting because during the pandemic, there has been like other projects like similar to this project that I did in the 2000, et cetera, that were dictated by the necessity for people to
be outside,
to be outside, as you said, and to view things from cars. That is like the way we go around here in Los Angeles. So there have been quite a big project, also a bit of project. Also, there was a project in Milano as well, I think, on billboards.
Right.
So.
And do you think that's gonna be? I mean, we're gonna see more and more of that, or is it temporary and it's only something that is happening now?
So I think it's possible. I just wanna add a quick thing. So I've been looking at art produced during the pandemic in LA. And there is one piece that I would like to mention that I thought was really cool by an artist that I work with. She's a friend, Diana Tater. And she did, unfortunately the show is down, but went down the other day. But you can access it through David Zwirner Gallery in website in New York. So Diana did this project in an empty space in Los Angeles. In fact, she asked me because I know she knows we have done projects together. She knows that's kind of my specialties. And she did this installation in an empty space that was accessible just online. So you would like just tune in on the link and look into the space where there were some cameras. So
you had to be physically in the space, or no? This was happening
from your computer.
I see.
You can do it from your computer.
This is even something else. It's like mixing a little bit, like being like.
About the strategy of exhibition during the pandemic. Right. So just bringing forward the theme of public space. So everybody could access through internet, and inside it was very beautiful because there were like some video just projecting colors, and there was the sound, and the sound was the song of a whale. So you know that the whale are singing to call their mates or like their friends. So there was just the sound of this whale that is called Whale 54, something like that. But it's a specific sound that is an unusual sound. It's not the usual sound of the whales. It has a different tone. So they thought actually this whale was probably deaf. There's something was wrong. So who is answering to this unusual singing? He's gonna able to meet other whale through this unusual singing. And I really like the symbolic of this installation. Sorry. And she titled it, quoting Bertolt Brecht, there will be, in the dark time, there will be singing.
Very appropriate with the moment, actually. So
exactly.
Lots of singing.
Because there is a lot of singing, but he's singing about the dark times. And so, but it's important that we continue to sing.
It is. And also, I think that the fact that they're actually connecting to each other through the singing, the whales, that's also something that we have experienced.
And it's like, can a song that is different from other songs still create connection? I mean, there is so much to... to very inspiring. I thought that was a very inspiring piece that I saw produced by an artist during the pandemic.
I didn't see that, but I didn't know this project. Thank you for mentioning it. I will definitely check it out. It sounds super interesting.
Yeah, I think there are still stuff online. You can check it out.
Yeah. Going back to public art, and then I think we're going to have to wrap it up. I wanted to mention that Luca is working on this project for in memory of the victims of the collapse of the Morandi Bridge in Genova, and that's also going to be outside, so that is public art. Do you want to say a few words about that project and maybe, you know, how you think, if you have thoughts about how people are going to experience public art moving forward from where we are today with the pandemic that is showing us that, you know, that's another way to.
So I was invited by Stefano Boeri, an architect in Milan, based in Milan, and to participate to the group of people that were working on the park, on the park in the area of the Ponte Morandi, where now there is the new Ponte, the new bridge did by Renzo Piano. And now, in fact, we are in a strange situation because we are waiting the decisions of the Genoese council,
the city council,
to start the permanent project that will start during the winter, and we should work for the next year. But now everything is blocked, probably also for the lockdown. So we are waiting for something to see how we can continue to work on the project. Until now,
but it is happening. It will happen. I mean, it's only a matter of time. But it will
they said like that. Yes, okay. We hope so. We hope like so. For the moment, there is only a temporary memorial that it was opened last August for the second anniversary of the collapse of the bridge, right. And in that case, we were Stefano Boeri and Petra Blaise from Inside Outside. That is a studio, a Dutch studio that collaborate to the project, and myself. And we did a circle of 43 different trees dedicated to the victims, to the 43 people that died for the collapse of the bridge. I'm quite happy about that because we worked very good with Peter and Stefano. It was very, very interesting experience, very also not strange, but hard meeting the families of the victims and to understand how to work, how to do. And was not easy at all. But now we are waiting to decisions and to see how we can start again to think the memorial, not the memorial, the park with the memorial, but everything that it should become the permanent project at the end. We did the temporary only because in August they opened the new bridge. So the city council asked to us to do something also underneath the bridge on the earth, that is.
Right. And also, you know, last summer and these days, it's so important to have outside spaces where people can go and see something beautiful. So. It's good that you did it last summer before the permanent project. I would love to keep talking about, especially public art, because I really care about this subject.
Yeah,
And I do feel that in the next few years, we will see a surge, a positive surge in this kind of art, because it's really what we learned from the pandemic is that we really need to have alternatives.
Time is mature, and it was mature, like for me already at the beginning of the 2000s, actually, the art to get out of museums and galleries.
Yeah, I agree. And, you know, what you did in LA is a perfect example of that, you know, using the whole city as an exhibition space. I think it's, I think we will see more and more of these kind of projects.
LA is particularly inspiring for this.
Yeah, for this. Well, I see that. I could see that in New York as well. If you want to come to New York and do the same.
There are good public art projects in New York as well. There are many.
Yeah, there's the Public Art Fund that does amazing things. Yeah.
Yeah.
But we do have to wrap it up. I don't know if there are questions from the audience. Looks like there are no questions from the audience, but I'll leave a few seconds before we close the conversation. If anyone has a question, this is the time to ask it. While I ask you, what comes next? What are you up to? What are you working on, Luca? What's your next adventure?
I'm working on two shows for next year. In two museums. One is in Weserburg Museum in Bremen, and the second one is for Maxi in Rome, two solo shows. And this is the main thing that I'm working on now. I have another idea of travel, a journey with a movie also. I'm trying to start, I start to work on it. And it's something that, of course, with the time that we live, I have to wait, but I spent 10 years to do the Romanistan project. I have also a few years to work for the next one.
You're in no rush.
Exactly.
But yeah, you're going to have to wait until you can travel again. Be patient. Amy, what are you working on? What's next for you?
I'm working on my book. I have 500 pages so far. I hope at one point I can finish it. I mean, there's going to be a huge, it's almost done. I have probably to write other 100 pages, and then it's going to be a huge editing job. I'm writing in English. It's going to be published in the US first, and then I will translate myself in Italian. And also I'm learning Sanskrit, which is... It was like always one of my desires to do this. I tried I started
the 90s.
Like 4 years.
From the 90s, what? You had this desire.
Yeah, but even from before, you remember that. So now I'm freaking fucking learning. So can I say fucking learning it?
You did.
I'm studying now with a professor from the Munich University of Sanskrit, and I will finish all the grammar by probably May, and then I start to do translation courses, and I hope I can translate something meaningful in like some philosophical text or something at one point in my life when I'll be 80 or something.
Well, then good luck with that. Sounds like a challenging task.
But it has been such a savior during the pandemic, because it's something that requires your full attention.
Perfect timing.
Able to
focus.
A safe space. It became a safe space for me.
Thank you for joining us today. I think we are wrapping it up. Thank you.
Thank you
to our audience.
Thank you, all of you from the Italian Cultural Institute. I hope that there will be soon conditions for inviting you in person to New York. And
I hope so too.
Be interesting together.
Yes, for sure.
So my best
Thank
wishes
you, Paolo.
For your project, and with Maurita maybe we'll continue thinking of something for the next few months to keep us busy
for the new year. Thank you. Hoping that the new year is gonna bring more live events rather than only Zoom events.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you, Maurita. Thank you, Paolo.
Thank you.
Thank you for this.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much.
And all the participants. Bye. Thank you.
Goodbye. Good night.